say welcome to everybody. Quite apologies from three members this evening. Pat Hackett, Mike Sullivan, Jill Wood. Steve's deputising for Pat Hackett. And we have that part with the deputies for the other two. So, okay.
Who are they? No deputies, no?
No, that's what I said. Are there any declarations of interest? And can we take it back?
Declarations of interest. Just that you are talking in the report back on the walls about applications that will come to planning committee. I feel relaxed that I can look at these plans without any preempting any decisions made by as a member of the planning committee, particularly the chair of the planning committee. So if you just would like that note, that's quite a question.
Thank you.
Resolve that by the end of the financial year to bring in a balanced position. The capital programme expenditure date is just under £6.5 million on a programme for this committee's area of £19 million. Okay. This is a breakdown of what I was talking about in terms of the Foulkes position. So the budget is £53.8 million and the spend, the predicted spend is £54.2 million, so at the moment it's an overspend of around £500,000. And that slide there gives you details of where the variances are at the moment. But like I said, we are trying to look at solutions, whether that's looking for extra income or looking at how we can do things in different ways to try and resolve this by the year end. And also looking more closely at some of our Foulkes as well to check that they're accurate. So I'll take you through some of the reasons. Variances on financial resources, we have overspend in relation to some agency costs and recruitment costs that relate to the senior management structure of the authority being recruited to during the last 6 months. On jobs and growth, we have an overspend which is to do with legal costs in relation to one of the auditors' projects. And on law and order, we have overspending enhanced payments and overtime payments in relation to the community safety team. And also, a small element of that expense is also down to an income target shortfall around services that we used to supply, which are being supplied down the contract stage. But we're trying to find ways of resolving that income shortfall. This slide is on the capital programme spend to date, and you can see that the bulk of the spend for this committee is in the area of highways and transport. At the last committee, we had questions around potholes and how much pothole fund spending has taken place this year so far. So you'll see in the report that at the end of September we've got £300,000 worth of expenditure on pothole work, and we have further amounts committed towards the end of the year. So we've got a grant funded scheme of just over £500,000 for potholes. You also ask about the West Kirby flood scheme at the last committee. That is a grant funded scheme. Consultation and work with the local residents started, and there was an article in Wirral View about that recently, the September-October edition. The final part of the presentation is just to alert members to the budget preparation for 1920. On Monday, Cabinet received and agreed a series of proposals for the next financial year. This committee has a workshop planned to look at some of those proposals, which will happen in the next 2 weeks. It's really just to alert members to that workshop taking place, and also the dates of Cabinet in the future. So there's a Cabinet meeting in February to approve the budget and the NTFS, and then finally a Council in March to agree the Council tax levels. And I put a few notes up there about the role of the committee in the workshops around reviewing the proposals that have gone to Cabinet, but the committee can also recommend its own budget proposals. These can be quite wide-ranging, looking at income generation, review of services, efficiencies. Finally, your comments on the new draft proposals must be made to Cabinet for consideration in February 2019. So just really running through that. Very similar to what took place here last year in preparation for the 18-19 budget. So, any questions?
Thanks for that, David. Just a couple of things. Potholes, you mentioned about £500,000 fund. Does that have to be spent by the end of the financial year?
Yes.
And then it's lost. Anything unspent is lost.
I'll check, but I think it has to be spent by the end of the year. The plans are it is to be spent by the end of the year.
It's just winter months for the potholes, and not the best months. And would have hoped, as Kathy said at the last meeting, that more of it would have been spent during the spring and summer.
Yeah.
We seem to have carried a huge amount out of it. So the worst time of the year, the wind potholes.
The spending in this report, which is to the end of September, was 300,000. I looked again today at the spend, and it is now closer to 450,000. So there is more spend coming through over the last 2 months as well. So there has been further work done since this report was put together.
Thanks for that, Jenny. Just one other point to make to Colin, really. It's regarding the workshops. I mean, our group is quite clear on this, with the same last year. We don't believe that meetings should be held in private that don't include the public. We believe all meetings to discuss any matters related to the council should be held in the public forum. So just to make that point.
You can
Thank you, Chair. A couple of questions. I apologise for putting up before, but I said I think you see some. The first one is in relation to the self-financing results of the August payment, in that we are having a major review of the council and offices currently going. I know we discussed this at the last meeting of this committee in relation to the plans we're paying for interim and people who are financing. But for budgeted 190,000 above for costing related to recruitment of senior management, surely going through the process of reviewing and changing the way the council is now, that sort of figure should have been in the mix in the first place, rather than something that's added on as an extra.
Are you saying the costs have come because the structure was agreed and then it's taken time to fill those posts?
And that's the extra cost to the authority.
That's how it's come through. That is not the case, obviously, going forward now, the posts are filled and we're getting to a 4-year picture in terms of 1920. We don't expect that to happen again.
I know you can't answer this, but how are we going to get that money back? That's an extra spend that we've had to incur.
If I could interrupt, Chair, I'll have to go on and have a massive nosebleed.
Try to pretend, even to propose areas for the council to look at in in the future of where money can be saved or it can be improved. So I would ask all members to use that opportunity, and if our learning friends across there have some great ideas for savings, then perhaps they can reveal them there, and the cabinet then, and the, you know, the leader of the council can certainly look at them with some degree of certainty that it's a suggestion from the other party. But if nothing comes forward, then I'm afraid, you know, you've lost the opportunity. So I would ask councillors to engage in that opportunity.
Yes, through you, Chair. The budget overspend for the first half of the financial year at £430,000, do you know what measures have been put in place to bring that back into target? And the cartel fund, I understand, you know, invoices come through at a later date, and you obviously know the figures for those for October and November. Do you know whether or not there is at the moment a budget underspend of around £160,000, which would bring the budget overspend back into line to be on target by the end of the financial year?
I don't know the specific details about 160 to bring the budget overall at the moment.
It's about a third, I feature. 160,000 would be about a third of the budget overspend to recoup that in the next 6 months, so 2 months, that would be about 160,000 roughly. So if you know there's a budget underspend of 160,000, you could realistically say, all things being equal, you're on target for the budget overspend to be not an overspend. But if there isn't a budget underspend in October and November, then the likelihood is that that could not be recouped in time for the end of the financial year in March. In fact, if there is still an overspend in October and November, the likelihood is that by the end of the financial year, the overspend could be touching a million.
What we do is when we review the forecast, we look through what is coming through. So sometimes some things that we are forecasting at the half year point change as we get into the later months, and that will come back. Obviously, we are hopeful that it will come back as balanced position.
But you don't know at the moment if that's tipping that way or not?
Not at the moment, no. I mean, what we're presenting here is the figures to the end of September.
Thanks, Chair. Okay, Chair. I'm going to play a nice slide, for the change. But first of all, was Councillor Hodson receiving generous aid of £439 for the first half of the year? Is that just for this particular quarter of oil or spectacle? Is that the outturn for two quarters?
That is the forecast position at the end of September for the whole year.
Okay. So it's effectively half year that we spent £439.
It's what we think the position will be at the end,
at the end of the year. Okay, so with regards to, this is the one that's a little bit all over the place, the figures. Let's see if we can clear this one for me. So during my last, the minutes of last meeting, there's reference to capital spend, capital budget rather, of £86.4 million for 18-19. Okay. Then at that point in time, I remember bringing up the point that we spent £2.1 million. At that point in time, but we quoted £2.1 million from a £43.5 million capital budget. Now we're quoting for 18-19 capital programme of £60.9 million, and we've spent £16.3 million. Which one is it correct? Is that to do with all areas of spend and just business areas of spend?
The higher figure is to do with the overall programme for the whole authority. So this is just looking at what is happening for business.
So we managed to actually get up to 16.3. I must apologise as well, but I rebel my apology to Mr. Whitting, Councillor Whitting, for questioning his ability to spend the pot, which is he's obviously just staying away from the last quarter. Being my wife, and that's also great to spend. And I can tell you that we'd only spent £33,000 last time in the first quarter, but we're up to £400,000 now. Last one, really, with regard to law and order, which they just brought up before. So we're showing on one table that we have approved deduction target, and it's going to be delivered of 30,000, I think it is. But on exactly the same page, we're showing that we've got an overspend of 57,000. So, whilst we've actually identified 30,000 that we're going to manage to save, we're still going to go over by 27,000 over the year.
Yes, what this table is telling us is what has been achieved on particular savings for that service for the year. So the saving is a particular item, whereas the overspend may be in a different area, is in a different area, if that makes sense. So while we can say that particular area is doing what we expect it to do, what's planned to do, in other areas it's not in line with the budget, and that's why you get this situation where it can overspend overall, but this part can be on track.
But yeah, but the law number is still running over budget, so that's effectively what that would indicate. I've got one more. I'm going to have to remind myself of the question once, because it was a couple of days ago when I actually wrote it down. I'm going to see if anyone else has come up for this.
Thanks, Chair. Thanks, Jenny. Just a question on page 19. Two of the items on the capital programme, maybe just my ignorance, I just don't understand what these are. One, towards the bottom, TAG feasibility studies and the Tarro National Productivity Fund. Can you enlighten us as to what those two items have to do with that?
I think the TAG one is to do with, I think it's something to do with transport. I don't know exactly what it's transport, sorry.
Is it to do with people getting free child benefits at the moment?
Yeah,
I
think it might be that.
If I can help Chair, through the years, TAG, the Transport Advisory Group, and that's a group that we sit on with our Merseyside colleagues. And this looks at a range of transport interventions, transport schemes. So this is feasibility work, which is co-funded and supported by the TAG group. And then the other one, which is the Town Road National Productivity Fund. Again, that's a national fund in terms of economic regeneration. But we'll have to be, as a council, we're also required to contribute to that as well as part of match funding. So I suspect that's where that figure comes in as well. And again, this looks at economic regeneration.
Thank you, Chair. Just clarification for me, that it's on the very last page, and it's not the second to last page. And it's two items in relation to the bringing Irene back in house. And there's two there. There's a sum of 305,000 and 145,000 to that. So is that over and above the original budget that we set for bringing them back in house? Or is that the figure that we started with?
So you're looking at the
band purchases? Yes. Band commercial settlements, and then further down is a band vehicle purchase, 145. Were they in the original figures when we did the change of work, or is this over and above? I know we did go back and argue over the work that did on the buildings, they improved the buildings that we had, and we paid more for that. Is this over and above again, or is this part of the original figure?
I'll have to take your brain and have a look at it and come back to you, because I don't know about the details.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thanks, Chair. Jennifer, Doc Bridges, the document says that further 0.8 million has been incurred in respect of the government replacement scheme. Now, is that additional to what had already been agreed contractually with the contractors who have actually been doing those works? Is that on top of, or is that part of the planned spend for that project?
Do you look at the Doc Bridges replacements?
Yeah.
And you look at the
808? 0.8 million has been incurred. A further 0.8 million has been incurred in respect of the government replacement scheme. Just by on one of the tables, it says there's an allocated 300,000 for that particular project. But then we've got a further 0.8 million, which will be.
I have to come back on that one as well. Okay. Sorry.
Because if it's a further one, that's where my concerns are peaked. Because I sat in a meeting with Councillor Jeanette Williams, who suggested that the council was now going to operate much more corporately. So if we're operating corporately, surely we have a specification and a construction requirement of the contractor with KPIs set out on what they're going to deliver now. But whether they're going over cost or not, that's not our issue. Contract should be screwed down, so that's exactly what the taxpayer pays. So that's what I'd like to know, if that is additional spending. Come back to us a later thing.
I would say, but my reasoning of that is saying it's a further 800 in terms of previous year's spend.
Plan payments.
Yes, yeah. So that's my reasoning for that spend.
If you can check that in the email or something, I'd do. Thanks very much.
Apologies, Chair. I may have not been here when this question may have been asked. It's a quick one on 358 on page 16, Jenny. West Kirby flood alleviation groundwork investigation currently being undertaken with a tender to be issued in November. My concern over that doesn't relate to the tender as such, but the fact that people don't know what it's to be tendered for. We're supposed to be subject to consultation. This, and I don't, as far as I'm aware, there's been no detailed consultation on exactly what's going to be provided. I just wanted to make that one of the chairs. I don't know whether you have any comment on that at all, Jenny.
Yes, I mentioned earlier on that there was an item in Wirral View about a series of workshops that was in Wirral View in September, October around the scheme that's due to be taking place. So that's been announced and the workshops are due to happen. I don't have the details of exactly when they're due to happen, but I can find out. But it has been announced in the review. That's taking place.
Well, that's interesting, because local people are still ambiguous and unaware of what's actually happening. But that's for another place to look at.
There's a
little
bit online, shouldn't you?
Can we another report then? And we'll move on?
Yes, please.
Targets. and this can only be a good thing. Clearly for me, the next stage is to ensure that we continue with this momentum. And you all know that this outline approval for almost 13,000 new homes in waters as a whole. The aim is to keep progressing those numbers to deliver as much brownfield as you possibly can. Again, to meet our housing target and take pressure off the greenbelt sites. So again, in that respect, it's a different session for me because it starts to move us from vision into delivery. I think that was the important thing for me, Chair.
Thank you, Chair. Brian, does that mean that the council is now and the leader, soon to be former leader, Cumbric, is wholeheartedly, including yourself again, behind Wirral Water now? Because that sounds a bit nuanced from the approach that was intermittent at the last full council meeting, whereby it almost sounded like the council had held up the white flag and it was waving it vigorously, suggesting that it wasn't going to come to anything, and that's why exactly why we needed to start building the greenfield and green plants around the water, including my ward. So does that mean we are actually going to try to, what's the word, push and drain as many one and two bedroom units, which are what we're actually short of in the borough, out of the waters as physically possible, which is what exactly what we should be doing.
Through you, Chair, yes, in response to Councillor. Clearly, Peel, one of the largest landowners in the borough, landowner of brownfield sites, in order to meet our housing target, they have to deliver. And again, you'll know that the vision's been great. But as we move towards examination of public as part of the plan process, we have to evidence delivery on site. The first 1,100 homes, we didn't start to move forward on that. I'd certainly like to see the other 12,000 come forward in short order to meet our housing target. Not forgetting, of course, that it will have to be nuanced because to evidence the housing inspector of government, we need a mixed approach to housing, one or two bedrooms or five, they will fulfill a particular housing need. But also, we still need family homes. So, as many family homes we can get on brownfield sites as well is really important. So part of my job is to ensure that yes, we do deliver on private rented accommodation for families and for downsizers, but also we don't forget the family home need as well. And I'm optimistic we can drive those numbers through brownfield sites too. I think at the moment on brownfield sites we're delivering upwards of 600-700 units a year, which is our highest ever number. We need to maintain that pace to keep the pressure off the greenbelt.
Thank you, Chair. Two questions and a comment. First of all, I'd like to say that a comprehensive report, and it was sat only 14 councils turned up for the event, but it was really well put together by both officers and Peel itself to show what's actually happening moving forward. Question I've got is in relation to Wirral Water, but I've links to both Wirral Growth Company and Birkenhead Town Centre. Given that, how are they moving forward? Will they be moving forward together? Or are we going to be one step behind in relation as an authority? Is we moving in the right direction? Are we ahead of the game now? Are we going to be there with the field moving forward?
Through you, Chair. Yeah, in response to that, clearly it's very exciting that we now have a number of schemes coming forward at the same time. We're making good progress with the use, our growth company partner. Again, we're looking to complete those legals very shortly. Offices are in Manchester today to start to finalise that process. Clearly the challenge we have now, and I've already started to broker meetings between the use and Peel, is to ensure that there's effective alignment of those two programmes, because clearly they do support each other. And not least for things like transport, digital, we have to ensure that we start to develop those two areas together so they don't compete. They don't trip each other up in terms of commercial and other floor space, for example. It needs to be effectively phased. In that respect, we're working with both of those partners to ensure that happens. I mean, this is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for the borough. So much capital investment long awaited. We need to ensure that we get the greatest value. We might maximise land values, maximise social value in particular as well, supply chain benefits, jobs, etc, etc. So my job, my deep job, to ensure that those two sector partners talk to our partners like the college, talk to the chamber and others to make sure we make those links and deliver those other objectives, but also primarily that we get the greatest value from those two investments alongside each other. And they're not competing, for example, for the same businesses for floor space, not competing for the same families for units, for example. So in that respect, we can work with those two to ensure that the timetable is aligned. But it's the same, it's a huge opportunity. And for me, I said to colleagues, met with my staff last week, 2019, you know, to start delivery for these programmes.
The second one, sorry,
yes.
Second question.
Okay.
It's in relation to the International Trade Centre, which was one of the original Gold Star things that was highlighted by Peel for the development of documenting. It's now died to death because they said themselves it's too high risk. It's now been moved out to Bromley, which is borders onto my ward. Given what's happened to a local car factory, it used to be at my ward, job losses, how are we moving in relation to moving the International Business Centre forward in Bromley to make up for that, which you're so few lost out there?
Scrap there?
Yeah, I mean, through you, Chair, I mean, that scheme, I think, it was something which was, it was never came off on Wirral Port, as you say, it was transferred down there. I think there's a wider point, Councillor, about clearly I was in the chamber this afternoon, this happens about how we can develop those jobs locally. And you've seen from the decisions at Oxford, for example. Increasingly, some of those things, or those decisions are out of our hands. What we have to do, therefore, is to do what we can do, what we can influence, which is to work with our partners to start to build skills, supply chains, social value, to make sure the things we are investing in for our own capital programme and with our partners, we squeeze maximum value out of. Because we do have more control over those than, say, a car company is based elsewhere. So that should be the watchword for us as a council, particularly our own spend, our own cap programme, schemes that we support, the schemes that we partner with. It's absolutely vital that we ensure that we get all the benefit from those, and they're not just individual capital schemes that we turn them to walk away from. In that respect, we're doing good work with the chamber, the college and others, working with Neil McEnroy and Claes, for example, around the Wirral Pound to make sure we maximise investment locally. Many councils have started down that road, Preston, for example. It's something we're just starting on, but for me, increasingly, it's about what we control and what we can influence, and we maximise that for our benefit, jobs and investment. And that has to be the future, particularly with the cold winds of Brexit as well, whichever way that goes. We have to be more reliant on our own devices, on our own partners, and less reliant on others, because we can't influence those things. So it's about being resilient as a council and as a borough.
Okay, Jerry.
Yeah, obviously you're going to be slightly cynical here, but you know, I'll ask the question, I know you've already answered it really, but I'll ask it again. I mean, is there a change in attitude in the field? Because we've had so many promises over the over the years. I mean, one of the things that I find, I've just come over four bridges and I see, full concrete signs with waters on. Is that the sort of sign of to say that the real holdings are thinking of the future? Because if that's the sum, what they commitments, questions have to be asked. But there's an element with the council here. We can take a course to water, but we can't make it drink, and that is one of the problems, isn't it? There are certain enforcement of the council. But this is the problem you've got with organisations with people, so many promises made. And of course the issue here is just the threat to our green belt due to these national government figures, one size fits all, is absolutely the greatest threat that we've ever had to deal with in all the years I've been on the council anyway, and that's certainly 20 odd years. But how do we, how can it, 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 how will the holdings come up with the goods? And that is the question we all want to know. And to be quite honest, I'm still full of skepticism in relation to their promises.
Through you, Chair. Yes, I mean, clearly when we have the workshop, you know, the vision looked very attractive, and I understand members have seen the way out previously. I think there is a change. Clearly, the Rural Waters One scheme was important to start the ball rolling on delivery. And I think those of you, when we had the presentation, Sulphur Keys was highlighted, and as happened, I used to work for Sulphur Council in the 90s. And I know there was a similar environment with the disused dockland, there was nobody in touch. That was brownfield, it was derelict. And the idea that people actually invest there and live there was pie in the sky. And actually, it's been delivered by Peel. So when we had the workshop, the question was put, well, you know, you've done it before, can you do it again? The challenge for them is a commercial vehicle, a commercial company. Is viability every time. Clearly, they're a big landowner for us, a big landowner of brownfield land. We have to ensure that we do all we can to help them bring that forward. And that includes things like planning, infrastructure, lobbying the government and others to get support to make it happen. But also often means us investing as a commercial opportunity as well. I think it is changing. But we have to remember, we're getting more conversion to council, and when, you know, we're starting to get into doing deals, for example. The key for me is that people will do it at their own pace. Exactly. You know, they're a commercial company. If it works, it works, and they'll do it. The flip side of that, of course, is when they're committed to something, they'll do it because there's money in it for them. And so it works. And so for me, looking at the Sulphur Keys example, if we can get Wirral Waters starting to make money for people, it's been a success. The challenge for us as a council is back to come to our social value, is to keep as much of that money in the borough for local benefit, and provide houses and other job opportunities for the people.
I mean, just coming back, I mean, the problem is that we, Peel Holding either delivering or not delivering, threatens our whole green belt of threat, and it's what about their environmental responsibilities?
Again, through you, Chair, yeah, that absolutely right about the need to put on a brownfield first. And again, we will keep the pressure on people to do that. As to environmental issues, clearly, when the application comes to the Chairman's Planning Committee, clearly, he would have responsibilities to deliver as part of any planning approval and consideration of planning application. Offices have been working hard with Peel and with other agencies, National England included, to ensure that all those environmental issues are fully addressed when it comes to a full planning application.
Thanks, Jim. I'm delighted that things have moved on, because clearly there was a lot of tension between Peel and the council, as was demonstrated in the letter from the legal council to people in the borough, and the letter from Richard Maudsley, which was published, which challenged those words and requested an apology. And after what Jerry said on the